This week, another episode of our MCU movie review show, Tim catches up with the MCU, previously available only on Patreon. This week, Mulele and I discuss Marvel's The Avengers from 2012. This conversation was originally released on Patreon on June 22, 2019. You can access more MCU movie reviews and reviews of Lee Ditko Spider-Man issues commercial-free by joining us for at least $4 a month at patreon.com/deconcomics. Welcome to Tim Catches Up with the MCU, a podcast about me catching up on Marvel Comics movies. This is Tim in Tokyo with Mulele on Skype in Tokyo. How are you?
I'm good. And you?
Okay. So, today I watched the first Avengers movie. I guess the official American title, Marvel's The Avengers. I guess the title varied a bit in some countries, but... anyway, so I guess to start off kind of generally, I mean, and not very much to my surprise, based on what I had seen so far and what I remembered about reaction from 2012?
Mm-hmm.
I thought this was the best one so far.
Mm.
I enjoyed it more than I had the first two that we watched doing this show.
Right.
Because, well, gee, lots of reasons. It wasn't set up. You know, we're done with a setup.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of got where those earlier movies were trying to go. Just, you know, there was a lot of fun stuff in it. A lot of, you know, really spot-on humor. And it wasn't just the humor that I laughed at. I found that, you know, just, you know, kind of the moments that, you know, appealed to my inner geek, you know, my inner Marvel reader for all these years. Just kind of, I was laughing just, you know, out of enjoyment of it.
Mm-hmm.
When Hulk caught Iron Man falling from the sky, I just had to start clapping. As I usually do after watching the movie, I read the Wikipedia page on it and I listened to iFanboy's review of it from, you know, that time. Maybe, you know, even though I haven't seen many of these movies, just from what I've kind of heard about them, I guess I was sort of, and maybe just I compared it so much with reading comics that, you know, that big fight at the end just seemed to work so well, and it didn't really occur to me that it could have been such a disaster.
Mm.
They were talking about, you know, how compared to like Transformers, it was shot so much better and just worked so much better overall. And also another way it could have gone wrong was just that, you know, you had three actors who had been stars of their own movies and, you know, try to make them work together, give them equal time along with some additional characters. But the balance was really good among them. You didn't feel like somebody was getting too much screen time or somebody was getting nothing to do. Like, I'd kind of forgotten about, you know, we talked before, we didn't remember anything about Iron Man 2 except the guy with the whip. iFanboy reminded me that Black Widow was in that movie and had nothing to do.
Huh.
Which I vaguely remember. That she just kind of stand around looking gorgeous. Where in this, you know, she was really badass and was doing spy type tricks, you know, like that first scene we see her in was really good, where it was so kind of subtle I didn't quite get it, but at first anyway, it looked like she was being interrogated, but in her mind she was interrogating them, and then she just starts beating them up while she's tied to a chair. Coulson just kind of calmly waiting on hold while she's beating everybody up, but was also great. We're talking about Scarlett Johansson, I was kind of impressed with her acting overall, like, you know, particularly after she's been chased by the Hulk, and, you know, she really seems kind of traumatized there. You know, it felt really real, you know, her reaction when somebody calls her on a communicator and she's just kind of, you know, still recovering from the experience she just had. And I guess that a lot of critics at the time were praising the acting in this, along with a lot of other factors. I don't know, just kind of random stuff as I'm looking through my scribbled handwritten notes. A few things, I don't know if I just spaced off a little bit or if they were a little too subtle, but I didn't quite understand at first why Barton and Selvig were helping Loki. Because I get, you know, he touches them with his spear and then they're helping him. And it was such a kind of subtle motion that I didn't quite get what the effect of that was. But then, yeah, later in the movie, somebody says, you know, oh, Loki has them under his control, and that's why they're helping. Okay, it was the spear thing. Okay. I picked up a detail of the Incredible Hulk movie that we skipped, in this version, the experiment that turned him into the Hulk was him trying to replicate something from the Super Soldier program.
Yeah.
It's interesting that they put that in when, you know, the Hulk movie was made before the Captain America movie.
Yeah, but the comics.
Comics fans would know exactly what he's talking about, but, you know, I'm sure there are a lot of people who have been watching these movies and never read the comics, so they might not have picked up what that was if they watched the Hulk movie first. We talked about, you know, or I talked about early on, you know, why I was never really into the Hulk. But I thought he was handled really well here. And as someone said on iFanboy, it's good to use him sparingly.
Mm-hmm.
The scenes that he was in, I thought, you know, worked, and it was good to see him, you know, as kind of the ultimate weapon against the invaders. And I really liked Ruffalo as Banner. How awkward he was. I really liked that. So let's see. Shield Helicarrier, good to see that. Of course, it almost got knocked out of the sky. That's been like a running joke in the comics, that every time you see the Helicarrier, it ends up crashing or almost crashing. Another scene I had to watch twice to kind of understand it. That when they go to Stuttgart, so I didn't quite understand why Loki was going after that guy's eye. And it's kind of unclear exactly what he did with the guy's eye. They don't show any close-ups of it. It looked like he was pulling the guy's eye out. I'm not sure. The second viewing of that scene, I said, okay, it's to unlock the door where Clint is. But I didn't quite get the connection between the two locations at first.
Right.
So then, you know, the heroes start to meet each other, and we get, you know, Thor Iron Man fight, which I really enjoyed, and then Cap tries to break it up, and I liked when Thor's hammer hit Cap's shield, and it just kind of leaves a crater. Mm. One point that I felt like was a little bit of a hole in the plot, that, you know, Barton's team sneaks up on the helicarrier and they're completely undetected until the bomb goes off. Like, don't they have any kind of radar that would pick up, you know, other aircraft in the area? Is it cloaked or?
No, they there's a communication between the helicarrier and the plane carrying Clint and his troops, where they ask him what they're carrying, and they said something like arms and supplies or something like that. So they were pretending to be a supply run on a cloaked ship. Now, it doesn't make a lot of sense to me, but that they did at least try to kind of say, hey, yeah, that they knew that they were coming, but it was they lied their way on.
Okay, wow, I missed that. All right. Yeah, I guess also I guess Loki was supposed to have taken over some other SHIELD agents, and not I thought he'd taken just Barton and Selvig.
No, they had tattoos, which is the classic I'm a rogue trained military person. Just a lot of non-rogue military people with tattoos, I'm sure, but yeah, it always means mercenary. So when they were prepping inside that plane scene where they're also explaining the how they were getting onto the ship, it's all kind of set up there.
Okay. Now I feel like there's probably a spoiler in here that you're going to want to tell me.
Sure.
I was surprised that Coulson apparently died.
He didn't die. He went to Tahiti. It's a lovely place. Have you been there?
Actually, on the iFanboy review from 2012, they were speculating that might have been a life model decoy. Don't say anything.
All right, what is a life model decoy?
It's essentially a robot. You know, robot replacement of a person. Actually, in the movie, Stark jokes about being a life model decoy when someone's trying to call him.
Right, right.
I think that's early in the film.
Yeah, that's right. He did say that, yeah. It's not really a spoiler if you want me to tell you what actually happened.
No, that's okay. Just tell me, when do they reveal it? Which movie?
They don't reveal it in a movie.
Hmm.
Coulson does not appear in any movies.
In the SHIELD TV show.
Until
Captain Marvel?
Captain Marvel, yeah. Okay. That's where he comes back.
I see. Okay, well then go ahead and tell me. I'm not sure we'll ever get around to watching the TV show.
Okay, well, basically, he wakes up. He's alive again. He doesn't understand why exactly, but he keeps having flashbacks of Tahiti. And I don't remember the entire thing, and I'm sure they went into it quite a bit, but they use some hocus pokery to bring him back to life, which becomes a plot line of SHIELD, the SHIELD TV show. But from what I understand, he died again recently, and in the final season, there's supposed to be like an evil version of Coulson that comes back to life. I don't know. At this point, that shit runs even more complicated than this set of movies does, and I kind of dipped after season 4 because everybody was getting a little too handsome, a little too muscular, and just a little too, you know, I'm fighting the good fight, but I gotta look sexy while I do it kind of stuff. And it was too American.
Okay. I like hocus pokery. That's a good word. I'm going to use that. Or do you have a copyright on it?
None at all.
Okay. So we've got this World Security Council that was kind of a surprise to me. I wasn't sure where they came from or who put them in charge.
Yeah,
And
wait, so that was Powers Booth, wasn't that?
yeah, I
Yeah.
noticed that. I'm trying to remember why I know his name.
Because he's got a great name.
But
I
yeah.
mean, what's his name? You just had a kid. Oh, his name is Powers.
Yeah, I looked him up. I noticed that he passed away a couple years ago.
Yeah, he did. He left the council.
But yeah, he's one of them. And of course they're all in shadow. That's a very comic booky thing. It's
I mean,
really
what?
impractical for talking to people, on Skype or whatever, but they're sitting in shadow and you can't actually see them.
It doesn't, you don't really need to have Powers Booth if you're going to have him just in shadow. I mean, he's a little bit better than that. It kind of seemed like a waste of him.
Yeah, although Wikipedia was pointing out that some of the characters, some of those World Security Council people turned out to, appeared again later as in kind of their civilian identities. I don't know which movie that happens in, or maybe it's on the Shield TV show.
I don't remember, but I don't remember them in the first four seasons of the Shield TV show. Maybe played by different actors. I don't know. It got kind of crazy boring sometime around the end of season four. So I just that was it.
A few points I picked up from Wikipedia. The street scenes were filmed mostly in Cleveland. They of course this New York stuff was well they took a lot of like photos and footage and stuff of New York and then kind of redid it as CGI. And they had to get the rights to have from each building in New York to have the building appear in the movie. I didn't know that was a thing, but
All right.
this is supposed to have been the first production where the actor playing Banner also played the Hulk. Because they had Ruffalo in the motion capture technology that was used in Avatar. And so, he's part of that mix. His face is in there. And his voice also mixed with some others, including the voice of Lou Ferrigno.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting.
He's still around, or at least he was in 2012, and they called him in to kind of mix his voice in to the Hulk's voice.
Lou Ferrigno is still around. He appears at conventions quite a bit. And not only is he healthy and active, he still, unlike Arnold Schwarzenegger, looks muscular. He's still built, he's still tall, he's still, you know. And I hear he's a really nice guy, but he charges for autographs, so I never got one of them. By the way, just a point on the motion capture. The Hulk in Ang Lee's Hulk was played by Ang Lee. I mean, the director's like, nah, I'm not going to give this to an actor. I'm going to be the Hulk. It's kind of a weird choice, but whatever.
I also today read Avengers number 1 from 1963, just because I was curious if I mean I knew I'd never read it before actually. I knew already that just like in the movie, something Loki does is what draws the members together to form the Avengers. But it's nothing as elaborate as what's in the movie, of course. It's just he's upset with Thor because Thor got him banished to this remote island, and he wants to get revenge on Thor, and he uses the Hulk to try to draw Thor out because he knows that Thor is Don Blake, in the comics of the time, but he doesn't. It's no fun to get his revenge against Don Blake. He wants to get it against Thor. So he trumps up a charge against the Hulk that's supposed to draw Thor out to fight Hulk or whatever. And the, well, you know who Rick Jones is?
Rick Jones?
Yeah, he's this. He was in the Hulk book from the beginning. He's this teenager who eventually becomes a rock star. I guess he had this, I forgot what it was called, but this sort of League of Teenagers organization, like in the Southwest, near the bombing range where Hulk got his powers. And he puts out he knows that Hulk was set up to, destroy this railroad. And he puts out a call to the Fantastic Four, and Loki reroutes this call, the wave, so that they don't get to the Fantastic Four, they go to Thor. Except that then they're also picked up by Ant-Man and the Wasp, and so they also go there, and then Iron Man shows up too, and so yeah, the Fantastic Four make a cameo. Actually, but yeah, it's just Loki trying to get revenge on Thor, and there's no invasion from another world or anything like that.
More Avengers discussion in a moment. Thanks to our supporters on Patreon, another set of classic early episodes of Deconstructing Comics has been unlocked, and I'm putting them back on the site in reverse order, for the most part. This week I'll republish number 38 from August 28, 2006, continued from the episode I republished last week. In this episode, Brandon talks about his approach to writing. Find the classic Deconstructing Comics episodes on our Facebook and Twitter feeds by choosing the earliest months listed in the sidebar pull-down menu at deconstructingcomics.com, in publicly available posts on our Patreon page, or in the Patreon smartphone app. Classic episodes have been unlocked back to number 31, so only 6 more classic episodes will be re-released unless we meet our next Patreon goal, unlocking 15 more classic episodes and putting our Fullmetal Alchemist podcast, The Law of Equivalent Exchange, in its own feed and on a more frequent release schedule. Check out all our goals and help us reach them at patreon.com/deconcomics.
Are you Batman? Oh, you must be, because that's Robin. Hi, Robin.
Yes, Batman and Robin are here, and Tim and Paul are also here to evaluate the Batman TV show that took the nation by storm in 1966.
How in the name of purple wombats do they manage it?
To the Batpoles podcast looks at the writing, the music, the guest stars, how the show fit into its times, and much more. Look for it wherever you get podcasts or at tothebatpoles.libsyn.com. Why, listening to the Batpoles even makes Season 3 enjoyable.
Gosh, yes, Batman. When you put it that way.
I found out that... are you aware of the Marvel Ultimate Universe?
No.
Okay. They shut it down a few years ago. It was going for, I think, about 15 years. I never read any of them because I didn't want to spend the money, even though they were reputedly good. It was like kind of different versions of the same characters. And actually there was an ultimate version of Peter Parker in Ultimate Spider-Man. And then eventually that was written by Brian Michael Bendis, who, for whatever reason, killed off Ultimate Peter Parker and replaced him with Miles Morales. And then when they shut down the Ultimate Universe, they had Miles pulled into the regular Marvel Universe. So he's the only character who survives from that.
Okay.
The invaders in this movie, the Chitauri, are something from the Ultimate Universe. In the Ultimate Universe, the Avengers were called the Ultimates, the Ultimates faced the Chitauri at some point.
Okay,
but I never read any of that. I guess that the way that Hawkeye is shown in this movie is also based on the Ultimate Hawkeye.
So, yes, I remember he had some sort of like purple mask.
Right. Yeah. The original Hawkeye. Yeah, he wore that purple mask and hood, and yeah, and it was a little bit different kind of character than this Hawkeye. Although the regular Marvel Universe Hawkeye has, I haven't read any of that stuff, but I guess they made him a little more like the movie Hawkeye, which happened with a lot of characters. They tried to make them look more like how they looked in the movies.
Yeah, they
found a way to make Nick Fury black in the comics. So, although I think that, from what I've been hearing, I think that's sort of blown over a little bit, and some of the characters like Hawkeye have sort of reverted a little bit more to how they used to be.
Okay, so it means Nick Fury is going to be white again?
That I don't know. I haven't even read a comic with Nick Fury in it in a long time. I'm not sure where he's appearing these days. In whatever form, whatever skin color. So, go ahead.
How do you feel about some of that stuff? I mean, I know that some people feel it's a little bit controversial, but just as far as them changing the race of the character from comic to comic or from comic to film.
Well, I think it makes sense because, you know, otherwise you end up with a movie full of white guys, and, you know, in this day and age, that doesn't fly anymore, I think. So, you know, you have to make it a little more diverse. And I know some people roll their eyes at that, but I think they just got to get used to it. Because, you know, there have been, you know, a lot of other, you know, less prominent groups in America who didn't get represented in entertainment much at all for a long time. So, yeah, I think it's fine.
Okay.
And, you know, Samuel L. Jackson does a good job in the role, so.
Well, not to prolong the argument too much, but some people have said that, you know, switching the race or gender of the character is not a good fix for this kind of problem. But in fact, a better way would be to introduce new characters who are different races and different genders and different sexual orientations, rather than just switching up the characters that are already there.
Well, I mean, I think in a perfect world we could do that, but I think, you know, people want to see the characters they're familiar with. So I think that maybe, I think they probably feel like if they introduce new characters, it wouldn't be the same. I suppose they could do it. I don't know. I mean, it runs into several issues here, I think. Are you talking about like introducing new characters in the comics and then putting them in the movies?
Well, understand how and why we have the Avengers movies now is because the X-Men were actually unavailable. They're the number one selling comic, not the Avengers. But the B-team was all that they had. So they started with Iron Man. In Japan, no one knew what the fucking Iron Man was. And in America, they're pretty fuzzy on it too, unless they were comic readers. But they went with that. They made a movie. The movie was mildly successful. So they charged forward, made a whole bunch of other films to introduce their characters. And then, boom, they did this one, which was actually good. And I don't think it went as far as catching the zeitgeist, but I think it went pretty close because it did something kind of new. Each of these people were set up as stars in their own right and then pulled together into one comic. I think it's just contractual, not really, oh my God, I can't believe they got them all to be in the same film. But considering that this was the B team, they could have actually done whatever they wanted. They could have done an Alpha Flight movie. They could have done a Power Pack movie. It just depends on how far they want to go with this stuff. I'll have to admit, Power Pack is not quite as compelling as Avengers.
No.
But
I'd sign on for an Alpha Flight movie.
Yeah, Alpha Flight, I wouldn't mind seeing Puck in action. We could get, what's his name, from Game of Thrones.
Oh, yeah.
I would love to see him as Puck. But basically, I think they could have done whatever they wanted, and they did this. I don't know how true they're trying to stay to the comics, or to what the spirit of the comics was, but because I, to be honest, I stopped reading a lot of this stuff. I'm very happy to watch the films, but I'm not so interested in the comics. Mm-hmm. But I just, I don't know, it's kind of a question in my mind. So what exactly is it? And I understand that the reason why there were no female solo films for so long was because some of the producers at Disney were women leading a film, they'll never buy it. And so, yeah, not only that, but no toys from what I remember. Mm. Or not many anyway. And people were pointing out at the times, like, you guys are Disney. You've got the Disney princesses. Why can't you add Marvel to that? I think they still want to kind of keep it separate, Disney princesses from Black Widow should not be a Disney princess, and neither should Princess Leia. So they're kind of keeping it a little bit off to the mm-hmm. side. Mm-hmm. But still, yeah, they might have had some other branding issues with that, but it's still just a curious question to me as to what exactly they're planning or why.
Well, one thing that occurs to me is, if they're going to be Marvel movies, they have to be characters from the comics.
Yep.
Now, these days, you know, not many new characters are created in Marvel comics because it's not creator-owned work. And now that there are so many opportunities to do creator-owned stuff, people want to create new characters in a situation where they can own them.
Right.
So it might be a little difficult. I mean, to some extent it's happened. You know, we got, you know, the new Ms. Marvel, who's, you know, Islamic.
Right.
And there have been a few cases, but I don't know. I think, you know, it's not quite as easy as just saying, okay, we're going to create some brand new heroes who happen to, you know, who are not, you know, based on Iron Man or based on Captain America. It's a completely new thing, with a new name that's never been used before, and they're, you know, Black or Asian or gay or whatever, mm-hmm. because people are going to, you know, the creators are going to want to do that where they can own the rights to it.
Well, I don't know. I think that there has been a lot of really interesting creative work done here with some smart scripts. This script being the first one for Avengers, being the first one that I thought was actually kind of fun and interesting. I've always liked Joss Whedon's writing, mm-hmm. The way he kind of subverts some of the tropes and themes that are there. And I found myself really enjoying and laughing a lot during the final battle of this film. Mm-hmm. But the first half, not so much. And one of the things I did hear about was the trick of this movie is that every battle is in kind of an enclosed or very tightly filmed space. The battle in the forest, the battle in Germany, the battle on the
helicarrier.
Yeah, the helicarrier. All of them are very tightly filmed. But then when you get to New York, it's really expansive, and there are a lot of wide shots, and there's always a lot going on. Mm-hmm. But also, it seemed to really the not only does the film kind of refocus there in a very nice way, the Avengers also focus there, and the script also works very, very well there. Whereas I felt the kind of the beginning of the film was kind of a setup. I kind of felt like, get to the shit. But when they finally got to the shit, then it was really, really good. And so that end battle was really nice, really amazing. Had a lot of good spots, good scenes. the scene with Loki and the Hulk. Classic.
Where Hulk mops the floor with him?
Yeah.
Yes, that was great. Yeah. But I mean, I enjoyed the setup part too, where they're kind of meeting each other and fighting each other, and because maybe it's just because I've read so many in the comics that you know that part, you know, maybe a lot more than the setup of the past two movies. This setup I thought was really enjoyable.
Okay.
So yeah, I enjoyed it all the way through.
Okay. I never read the Avengers, and so my I guess vision of them is they're kind of like the Super Friends, and so to see them kind of squabbling and fighting with each other seemed a little bit kind of this is, come on guys, just get your shit together.
Well,
was that the comics?
Certainly the first few, well, they mentioned on iFanboy, actually, the first few issues of the Avengers from 1963, they don't like each other and they're all fighting all the time. And actually I bought electronically, or borrowed, I guess, cause I'm on Comixology Unlimited, the first, you know, volume collection of that stuff. So I want to get a chance to read it, but in Avengers 4 is when Captain America is found frozen and thawed out. And I think, I'm guessing, having not actually read those issues, but I'm guessing that having him there kind of smooths things out. I mean, just like, you know, in this movie, you see they're in the battle scene and Captain America's giving orders. I mean, that right. And that fit, you know, his comics version perfectly, I thought. And I can imagine him becoming kind of a unifying figure for the rest of the disparate group in the original comics. So yeah, I mean that fighting is true to the original series.
Okay, then I can, I guess, accept it a little bit more.
Well, and you know, Marvel has always been about, you know, slightly dysfunctional characters anyway. You know, that was, you know, what was revolutionary about them in the 60s. So, you know, that's, you know, perfectly on brand.
Right, okay. I guess I never quite looked at the Marvel comics quite that way. With the X-Men, I can see it a little bit more because I read that regularly, but I wasn't, it wasn't made painfully aware to me how dysfunctional these heroes were when I was reading the comics, I guess. I was like, oh yeah, everybody's got problems, I got problems too, whatever, but you know, they got superpowers, whatever. And it didn't really hit me that, oh, these guys are fucked up. What is this shit? Whereas in this movie, I kind of felt it a little bit more.
Yeah. Okay, well, did you have anything else to bring up here or to ask me?
Not really to ask, but just to say my bit. This film, I think, is the best of the films that we've watched so far. I do want to go back and look at Iron Man 2 because the idea that Black Widow is in it and I don't remember her in it and I don't remember the film, it kind of bugs me. It is a part of Phase 1, and I just kind of, this is the last film of Phase 1, and it's when I kind of explore it a little bit, and maybe I'll really fucking hate it. I know that what's his name who played the bad guy really disliked what they did with his character. That he felt kind of cheated, Mickey Rourke. That as a bad guy there was a lot more to the character, but it wound up on the editing room floor. So I don't know, I'm gonna see what I can glean from it.
Oh, by the way, speaking of Phase 1, I noticed that the World Security Council people use that expression, Phase 1. So yeah. Do the phases of the set of movies sort of fit with something that's actually happening in the movies?
Not beyond Phase 1.
Okay.
Maybe they don't go around in Age of Ultron saying we're in phase two.
No. Although in Endgame, they do go around saying we're in the Endgame. I think it was actually in Infinity War. They go around saying we're in the Endgame. This is the Endgame. That's the Endgame. it was kind of name dropped in a few movies, but I don't know, maybe they were prepping people for the idea that this is phase one and that's phase two, because once they hit phase two and they were doing all the press releases and stuff and talking about phase two, phase three, currently we're hearing rumors as far as phase six. And I believe Spider-Man Far From Home is the end of phase four.
Okay, yeah, that's supposed to come out July 2nd in the US.
Sorry, phase three, sorry.
Phase three.
Yeah, that's the end of phase three, and phase four will introduce new characters, including Miss Marvel.
Okay. Yeah, according to Wikipedia, I don't know where this information comes from, but I didn't check the references. After Spider-Man Far From Home, there's supposed to be a Black Widow movie.
Yeah, there is.
Date is TBA, but...
Yeah, no, they're taking a year off.
Okay.
All of this. So after Spider-Man, there'll be nothing until 2020.
Okay, well, by that time we should be caught up so we can watch Black Widow in the theater and talk about it.
Actually, I would like to watch Spider-Man in the theater.
What do you think, man? Well, I would too, but I don't know if we can get there that quickly.
All right, well, you kind of have to watch all of them in order because each one spoils the next one, or rather the following one spoils the previous one.
Yeah, so, well, I understand that Far From Home is supposed to tie up some stuff from Endgame.
Quite a bit, it seems, and introduce quite a bit. I have a feeling the Spider-Man one is going to do some major setups, and without spoiling anything for you because you haven't seen Endgame yet, I can't really talk about it. All I can say is do not watch the trailer.
Okay.
No, the Russo brothers who directed Endgame said 11 days, 2 weeks, or I forget exactly how long it was, something like 2 weeks after the film comes out, we're putting out this trailer for Spider-Man with spoilers. If you haven't seen Endgame, look away. But there's going to be spoilers in it. And
well, I've seen so few of them, I might not even understand what the spoilers are. I just go, huh?
No. If you know the characters, you'll know.
Okay.
And you know the characters, so that's enough. Just stay out of it. But it sets up quite a bit of stuff, and to mention it here, you kind of have to be led up to it, mm-hmm. led up to it all. And so the thing of these films, and I'm not spoiling anything here, but they kind of go by leaps and bounds as far as the amount of information that it crams into you if you're really paying attention to it. And actually, that is one of the things that I wanted to comment on this movie as well. I had it and I just lost it. Oh my God, I'm losing my mind.
Yeah, I know how you feel. I have memory. You know, I used to be the guy who remembered everything, and now I'm like forgetting stuff half the time.
Yeah, but, you know, I was never spry. Like, even in my 20s, I wasn't spry. So now at 48, I'm like, what were we talking about? But, it's on the tip of my tongue, but I can't remember. I'll remember it once we finish recording, I'm sure. Anyway.
Okay. Well, I was going to say, Disney bought Fox, right?
Yeah.
So I assume that that means that they're going to bring the X-Men into the MCU. I heard Dark Phoenix is supposed to be the last non-MCU X-Men movie.
Yep.
Yeah, so I suppose Phase 4 or 5 will see some MCU X-Men.
Well, so people are saying that the Dark Phoenix movie is not good. Like, really, really not good.
Hmm.
It's got a 22% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Ouch.
Basically, one of the main criticisms is that none of the actors want to be there. and it shows on film. No one's interested.
Hmm.
They pushed it back 2 years to release it this way. And it won't break 100 million in the U.S., not 300 abroad.
Why are the actors not into it?
Don't know. Maybe they're like, oh, this is the last one. Contractually obligated. Maybe their contracts were up after this film.
Hmm.
But a lot of them were just like, eh, whatever. And there were a few notable actors who particularly did poorly this time out, even though they're fine actors.
Hmm.
I haven't seen it, so I can't really comment beyond what these other people have said. But word on the street is, because of this nonsense, it kind of leaves a sour taste in the mouth that Marvel wants to avoid. So it may be pushed back a bit. Some people are saying 2 or 3 years, some people are saying 5 years, and some people are saying a decade.
Wow.
Yeah, but we have a unannounced, well, untitled movie announced for early 2020, and people are beginning to notice that there's a vacuum around the name Fantastic Four. It's all speculation. But we'll probably get them first before we get X-Men.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so next one will be Iron Man 3, starting Phase 2. So we'll see you next time. Thank you, Mulele.
Thank you. See you next time.
Okay.
Get access to all our commercial-free movie reviews and discussion of Lee Ditko's Spider-Man issues by supporting us on Patreon for at least $4 a month. Last week on Patreon, we released a discussion of Amazing Spider-Man 15, the first appearance of Kraven the Hunter. Join our Patreon now so you'll get the next episode as soon as it comes out. Your support helps us continue to make Deconstructing Comics, Critiquing Comics, To the Bat Poles, and our newest show, The Law of Equivalent Exchange. Check out our tiers and goals and choose your level of support at patreon.com/deconcomics. A new Critiquing Comics is coming up this Saturday with an unexpected co-host. Then next week, The Law of Equivalent Exchange is back. Patrick and I talk about the shocking fifth chapter of Fullmetal Alchemist. See you then.